Thank you. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion S6M15006 in the name of Gillian Mackay on North Lanarkshire School Bus Campaign. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Gillian Mackay to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to thank all colleagues who signed the motion to allow this debate to happen today. And before I go into detail about the motion, I'd like to extend my thanks to the many parents across North Lanarkshire who have contacted me to share their personal experiences of how these proposed cuts will impact their families, including Laura, Jim, Leona, Diane, Lorraine and Kerri-Anne, who are joining us in the public gallery today. The determination, commitment and continuous campaigning from these parents has been inspiring, uplifting and should be a reminder of the power and the importance of local issues. 590 parents from across North Lanarkshire have signed the petition to overturn this decision. The reduction in children's school buses across North Lanarkshire is a disaster for children's safety. I hope that North Lanarkshire Council and the Scottish Government can take immediate action to deliver a workable solution. For background for those members who represent other areas of the country, in North Lanarkshire, local councillors have implemented cuts to school buses for secondary school pupils by increasing the distance children have to be from their school, from 2 miles to 3 miles at secondary school, and have proposed that the same happens for primary schools, moving their qualifying distance from 1 mile to 2 miles. This will have a significant impact on a large number of young children, causing them to rely on their parents to drive them to and from school every day. Families and teachers from right across the region have already spoken out against this decision. It's clear that these cuts will put children's safety at risk by packing more cars onto the already crowded streets around school grounds, areas where children are walking and cycling in large numbers. It will also increase air pollution and carbon emissions around schools at a time when we are becoming increasingly aware of the damage this can cause, and it will add an extra burden to parents and carers who are already struggling. It's already having an impact at secondary schools, with some reporting up to a 30% increase in cars, pupils leaving campuses to get into parents' cars in queues, walking along grass verges of dual carriageways. How on earth can anyone think that is safe? My inbox has been inundated with correspondence from parents, teachers and members of the local community who are rightly very concerned about children's welfare. I've had particularly moving conversations with parents of children with additional support needs who rely heavily on their school buses and the importance of routine that the school bus allows their children. And I want to share some words from a parent who I spoke to recently. She said, and I quote, "My child doesn't have social awareness or safety awareness due to his autism. On walking from home to school, he would need to cross two very busy main roads and cross through a park which another high school sits on. On Hamilton Road, there's a gap of roughly half a mile between traffic lights to get safely across the road. And on Airbles Road, the distance is longer. He wouldn't be able to process when was best to cross the road between traffic, which would lead to a breakdown with anxiety over how to get across. It's the same with trying to access public transport. Most buses are either full or nearing capacity when they reach his stop. The heightened noise on the buses would be overstimulating for him, and this could also lead to a stressful and traumatic experience. I believe there's been a gap of understanding of the needs of all children with additional support needs and not just the ones with mobility issues." Yes, absolutely.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful for giving way. Isn't the point, though, that there's been so little consultation with the parents? It's not a case they haven't been listened to. They haven't even been spoken to properly.
Gillian Mackay.
There's been an element of consultation in some places. The parents definitely do not think it's enough, but other schools have been told that they didn't have to engage with the process of consultation and have then found that their buses have been cut. So I do agree with Mr Kerr on that point. It's been suggested by members of the local authority that children and young people should simply use the service buses instead. But we've had reports of buses not stopping or ones that are overly busy. In some places, there's only one bus an hour, and if it's full, children face a long walk or a wait outside school for the next one. North Lanarkshire Council say they're following Scottish Government guidance, but there seems to be no consistency across local authorities as to how this is being interpreted. And as a Scottish Greens MSP, the party who proudly introduced free bus travel for everyone under 22, I find the suggestion that children as young as 4 years old should use public transport as an alternative to their school bus to be concerning. Since it was introduced, thousands of young people have benefited, taking over 50 million bus journeys, and it saved family members during a cost of living crisis. But it shouldn't be used to plug gaps. Yesterday, I walked one of the proposed walking routes with parents and pupils in Motherwell. I sincerely hope others will take up the opportunity to walk the route, and I know some have already been out and that the parents were really pleased at the support. The route is simply not safe. We walked along busy roads, along narrow paths and over broken glass. One of the children told me they wouldn't be comfortable walking the route without an adult because they didn't feel safe. We as politicians try to put across arguments in a compelling way, but I think it's only fitting that the final words are from one of the pupils affected. Ella is 10 and from Motherwell and sent me a video detailing the challenges as she sees them. And she said, and I quote, "The people in charge of North Lanarkshire Council have decided to stop our school buses in order to save money. I don't think this is fair. It's the wrong decision. The school bus gets lots of children to school safely and on time. If I didn't get the school bus, I'd need to walk a really long way in the rain to and from school. Between my house and school, there are big, dangerous roads that are especially dangerous for younger children, like my brother and sister. They'd be tired and cold before we even get to school. 129 children from our school will lose their bus next year. I worry that our school campus will get really busy and dangerous with lots more cars. This is also bad for climate change. I thought grown-ups were trying to stop as many cars being used on the road. Then why take away our buses? It doesn't make sense. I want the grown-ups in charge to put our safety first before saving money. I share Ella's concerns. The proposed cuts will put children's safety at risk by packing even more cars in. Taking children to or from school for some parents will cause more hassle in the morning with parents trying to get children to both secondary and primary schools because of the cut to the buses." Yes, absolutely.
Megan Gallagher.
Gillian Mackay for taking the intervention, and I don't disagree with anything that Gillian Mackay is saying, but does she know how much is forecast for the council to cut over the next 3 years? And does she agree with me that we will be discussing a lot of these issues in relation to what services will need to be cut because of the budget settlements that are delivered to local government?
Gillian Mackay.
I think we will be discussing these, but I think we need to hope that councils will take sensible decisions that won't actually put children's safety at risk, which I think is why this is such a disastrous cut. And because of the lack of consultation, as Stephen Kerr has already pointed out, I realise I'm running out of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, so I'll finish. I'm calling on the Scottish Government to look again at the guidance to ensure this can't happen in another local authority area, and for both the Scottish Government and North Lanarkshire Council to do the right thing for children. Reverse the decision for secondary school pupils and commit to protecting the current bus entitlement for primary school pupils.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. We now move to the open debate. Speeches of up to 4 minutes. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Mr MacGregor.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank Gillian Mackay for bringing this very important issue to the Chamber today. Like Mrs Mackay, I've received a significant number of inquiries from constituents regarding these changes to provision, and like all my colleagues, I've written to North Lanarkshire Council on numerous occasions, representing my constituents' views and ensuring that their dissatisfaction with these changes is made known. In May, along with Claire Adamson, I also met with the Minister, where we asked that he write to North Lanarkshire Council and encourage them to meet with the communities affected and elected representatives to help us all understand how these assessments were being made and hear the ongoing concerns. Now, in my constituency of Coatbridge and Creyson, there are three main routes that are affected by the changes to secondary school transport provision. The approximately now 2.8-mile walk to Coatbridge High and St Ambrose High from Burgady, the between, depending on where you live in Steps, the between 2- and 3-mile walk from Steps to Creyston High School, and the over 2-mile walk from some parts of Carnbrough and Coatbridge to Coatbridge High and St Andrews High School. I quite agree with the motion that Gillian Mackay puts forward. Walking routes should be suitable. They shouldn't be via an unlit canal on dark, cold nights, a route that has been deemed suitable by North Lanarkshire Council in my constituency for those walking the over 2.5 miles from Burgady, or not expecting children to walk alongside dual carriageways, a reality now facing those again from Burgady, but also those from Steps expected to walk alongside the busy Glasgow Road and A80 respectively, both roads which had until recently speed cameras on them and are often considered accident hotspots by local people in the two respective areas. As well as the obvious impact on the safety of pupils getting to and from school, if they walk, these changes will also impact on traffic as parents resort to driving the children to school, not exactly good for the environment. And worse, I have concerns that some parents will simply keep their child off school on days when it's dark, snowing or blowing a gale, where their child is expected to walk over 5 miles that day carrying their books, so not exactly good for closing the attainment gap. And while I appreciate Ms Mackay's call on the Scottish Government to ensure school transport guidance is suitable, the safe walking routes criteria is currently decided by local authorities, and North Lanarkshire have failed to review theirs since 2018. It is for local authorities to determine the nature of the provision they offer. This decision lies so slowly with North Lanarkshire Council, and it is my hope that the member officer working group recently proposed by the SNP group will remedy this.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank Philip McGregor for taking the intervention. I absolutely agree that the guidance around safe walking routes and things is for the Council. But because the Council are using the Scottish Government's school transport guidance as an excuse, does he not think we should tighten that up to make sure it can't be used in another Council to affect the same as we're seeing in North Lanarkshire?
Philip McGregor.
I'll come back to what we can perhaps do, but I think everything is on the table, but I think we do have to respect where decisions are local authority decisions. Because what I was going on to say is I think the main issue at play here with this particular decision is that of parental engagement. This, for me, is not a bash North Lanarkshire Council session, as there are many good things that my local council area does. Just this week, for example, we heard from the head of Housing at Committee about some of the great work that has been done in the housing sphere. But I think with this decision, both for secondary and the soon-to-be-implemented primary school transport, the council and the councillors from the ruling group have simply imposed this decision without relative engagement with the communities. They have not taken the people with them, and I think all elected members can see that in the terms of the amount of correspondence we're receiving. Indeed, my constituent Diane, who's in the chamber today, believes that the lack of engagement is contrary to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and Scotland's own Parental Involvement Act 2006, and I know that she will have made these feelings known to the Council. I have been given full reassurance from the North Lanarkshire Council SNP group leader that she will push for parents' representations to be heard on the member officer working group that has been set up to review and update the criteria used in assessing school transport provision. And I'm also told that this has been communicated to key figures in the community, including those in the grassroots NLC Transport Action Group. And I would like to take a moment just to pay tribute, as Gillian Mackay did, to members of that group. Far too many names to mention, but including Marissa, Leslie, Diane, Lorraine and many, many others, and it's not intention to leave anybody out there. I would say that the SNP have shown an unwavering commitment to preventing these cuts. The North Lanarkshire Council NLC group were the only group that presented a fully costed budget proposal in 2023, which did not include cuts to school transport.
The member is about to conclude.
And for those unfamiliar with the setup, these cuts were implemented as a result of the Labour Conservative joint budget. So I would like members across the chamber, including Gillian Mackay and any Conservative members that are going to speak, to consider how councillors voted in this. Free bus passes, presiding officer, are welcome. But they're not without issue.
Mr McGregor, you will need to bring your remarks to close, please.
I did have more to say, but thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you very much indeed. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Mark Griffin. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, presiding officer. I'm not going to make my comments party political. I don't think children's safety is an issue which should be party political. And I'm going to present an idea to the Minister at the end, because I am one for solutions. He knows that. Now, I think North Lanarkshire Council has got itself into a bit of a mess here, and part of the reason for that is the way they consult or don't consult with parents. They're not the only council who does this in a cack-handed manner. Often decisions are imposed on people, in this case parents. Councillors are reassured by officers that processes have been followed when perhaps they haven't been. And I'm not going to stand here and blame councillors for taking a decision which takes a council to the legal limit, because I've been in that position myself as a councillor in South Lanarkshire. These are tough decisions to take, and all councils are up against it budget-wise, and that's why they end up in the position they are. But we have of course.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
He mentions the budgetary challenges. Of course, there are budgetary challenges, but the fundamental point in this case is that there were a group of councillors, SNP councillors, who identified funding, an underspend of £8 million by North Lanarkshire Council, identified just over £2 million of that to keep the bus service going, to continue to provide school buses, and it was in fact voted down by a combination of Labour and Conservative councillors, and I should declare an interest, presiding officer, being the father of two children who have lost their school bus provision.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, I said I wasn't going to make it party political. I'm not going to make it party political. I'm describing the challenges that councillors face. But we end up in a situation where school buses are being withdrawn, and that puts some children, not all children, but some children at risk. I've also walked one of the routes. That was from Steps to Cryston, and it was along a busy dual carriageway. Would I walk that route to work? No, I wouldn't. Would a teacher walk that route to work? No, they wouldn't. So why would we expect a child, possibly at the start of their high school journey, to do the same? I don't think you should. My suggestion, though, is that we actually have to look at this in the round and accept that there is a problem throughout Scotland with the school run. There are too many cars being used to take kids to school. So we need to rethink things. We have council officers, perhaps even government ministers, in an entrenched position of saying, well, that's the legal limit, that's all we have to do. Well, actually, what we should be looking at is the whole issue of there are too many cars on the road taking kids to school. So I think there is perhaps a role for government here to say, well, let's rethink this and let's have a look at, can we do things differently, come up with a different system where we councils, maybe it is councils, could organise buses. Maybe some parents could be asked to contribute towards that. I know some, a lot of parents won't like that, but the issue is there is a lack of provision now in a lot of council areas to get kids to school, so they're put in cars. That adds to congestion. It takes away from safety. So I think we just need a rethink. And if the minister, who won't come up with any solutions today, I don't think, but if he can accept that we need to relook at this and end the school run throughout Scotland, then we may get something positive out of this.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I now call Mark Griffin to be followed by Megan Gallagher. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Perhaps I should declare an interest as well in the same vein as Mr. Hepburn, in that two of my children will cease to get their entitlement to the bus provision next year. But what the motion in front of us asks is that the Parliament notes with regret the reported reduction in school buses in North Lanarkshire. And of course, we do note that with regret, just like every councillor that made the decision to reduce school transport provision regrets that they felt they had no other option but to make this change in the face of budget cuts from this government. But what I do find strange, though, in this motion, is that there is no regret for the cuts to local councils, which have forced them to make this decision. There's no context at all around the financial situation councils across the country of all political persuasions find themselves in. North Lanarkshire Council raise less than 20% of their own revenue. Just if I get to the end of this point. North Lanarkshire Council raise less than 20% of their own revenue in line with most other councils. So the cuts they are being forced to make as a direct result of budget decisions made by this government. And we should be clear and honest about that when it comes to criticising decisions made by councils. And I'll take Mr. Hepburn.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
It's an attempt at another attempt at the point I just made to Mr. Simpson. I do not underestimate the challenges for local authorities. But would Mr Griffin reflect on the fact that there was an £8 million underspend at North Lanarkshire Council, identified by SNP councillors? They said £2.2 million or thereabouts could have been used to maintain bus services, and it was voted down by a combination of Labour and Conservative councillors. Would you not just accept that as fact?
Mark Griffin?
Single-year underspends, raiding reserves, we hear the same things over and over. These things can only be spent once. This is a recurring cost to the council. Now, MSPs have, you know, rightly criticised the cuts the Scottish Government budget have received over the years, but these same MSPs seem to be strangely silent when those cuts have been multiplied and then handed on to councils. What councillors are now left with doing is choosing between lots of bad things. There are no more positive choices to be made in the world of local government, only where to make cuts after a decade of deprioritisation of council budgets. It's choices between school buses and teachers. It's choices between teaching assistants and school buses. It's choices between breakfast clubs and school buses. It's swimming pools, libraries, potholes, grass cutting, play parks. All of these council services being pitched against school buses. Now, 27 other councils have already made this decision. Some only provide the statutory minimum, and yet we have no motions of regret here for those decisions. Now, Presiding Officer, government ministers and backbenchers regularly tell opposition MSPs that if they want to reverse spending cuts, then we need to tell them where the alternative cut should be made. They need to start practising what they preach, because when it comes to council decisions, because councils all over the country are now reverting to statutory minimum levels of services across all departments, not just on school buses, because of those government cuts. But where I do agree on this motion is that all walking routes should be robustly assessed for safety. And if it's not safe, then free transport absolutely should be provided. I also agree that the Scottish Government should engage with councils on this issue, because the guidance on assessing the safety of school walking routes is set nationally by this Government, and I'm sure the parents in the Chamber and across the country will be interested in hearing from the Minister on any proposed change to that guidance. Now, North Lanarkshire Council have been clear that if this Government want to revise the national policy to reduce the mileage limits or the guidance on safety, to provide the appropriate funding nationally in light of any substantial changes to that policy, especially when we consider the increases in year to this Government's budget and substantial increases to the Government's budget next year, then I understand North Lanarkshire Council stand ready to look at this decision again in light of changes to guidance and increased funding. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Mark Ruscoe. Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon, albeit MSPs have no jurisdiction to reverse the decision to cut school buses in North Lanarkshire, but it is an important debate all the same. In the interest of being open and transparent, I was a councillor between 2017 and 2021, and I also led the Conservative group on North Lanarkshire Council as well. Now, regretfully, it comes as no surprise to me that North Lanarkshire Council eventually took the difficult decision to reduce bus services to statutory guidance. Guidance, might I add, and rightly pointed out by Gillian Mackay, that was created in this place. As a councillor, this particular cut was on the table when I was leading my group through budget processes, and it has been year on year. But this, of course, does not make the decision right, but I'm hoping to use my time today to put a timeline of events into context, because, and I think we can all agree, cuts have consequences, and budget-setting processes in councils are becoming near impossible. Because if you look at council budgets in the round, roughly 14% of council tax payments from taxpayers make up the full core budget. The rest, they rely on funding from the Scottish Government, and this comes at a heavy cost, because ring fencing is restricting choice for councillors who are faced with the impossible decision of searching through a menu of cuts outlined by council officers to pass a balanced and legal budget. When education takes up roughly 50% of the budget in North Lanarkshire, there is little to no wiggle room for any service that is non-statutory. That's why North Lanarkshire has lost services such as Club 365, Kilbowie. They're now going to charge for brown bins, the removal of librarians, reducing classroom assistance, and we are considering to close swimming pools and community centres. I don't think any politician in their right mind would reduce or close services unless they absolutely had to get that balanced budget. Because the forecast of cuts, and I think this is a really important point, it's why I was asking the question earlier on, the forecast of cuts for over the next 3 years for North Lanarkshire Council is circa £60 million, on top of the quarter of a billion that's already been cut since 2013. That's communities that Gillian Mackay, that Fulton McGregor, that Mark Griffin, that I represent. The communities will need to brace themselves for more pain and suffering this year. And I think this could have been reflected within the motion today. Because, like many of us, I'm completely fed up with the state of local government, and I'm completely scunnered that communities bear the brunt of poor political choices. But now, moving on to the buses themselves, when I was a councillor, I fought hard not to cut school buses at a time when the council was skint. Councils aren't skint now. Councils are at the brink of bankruptcy. We've completely surpassed the point of councils being skint. And I don't think I'd want to be a member elected to a local council now, having to face communities knowing that any decision they take will impact the poorest, the disabled, the elderly and our children. North Lanarkshire Council, they have agreed to a review of walking routes to schools that are not deemed as not safe through a member officer working group. They were not safe back in 2019 when this was reviewed, so I don't know why this would have changed and why we're now having a repeat of discussions that took place back then. Because when we look at this in the round, it comes down to children. It comes down to children's safety. And I'm disappointed that parents' groups have been excluded from the decision-making process. It's their children who will be directly impacted. So I am asking the Council through my contribution today to apply some common sense to ensure that the UNCRC is adhered to and that parents can actively be involved. They don't want to cause trouble. They just want to make sure that their children are safe getting to school and back home. As a parent, I do understand the fear about having children walk dangerous routes as there's no buses supplied by the council to get them to school. And I wouldn't tolerate that for my daughter being placed in a dangerous situation. And the same goes for any child in North Lanarkshire. Whether the decision to reverse the cuts to school buses takes place, well, that's ultimately a decision for councillors, as this government, they won't step in. And I do applaud the parents who are taking a stand today and are with us in the public gallery. Yet I'm fearful that this is only the beginning of many unpalatable, difficult decisions that will need to be taken over the next 3 years. And it is incumbent, as MSPs, that we continue to fight for local government so we don't have to debate more motions like this in this place that is surrounding cuts to local government funding.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. Thank you. I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Claire Adamson. Mr Ruskell.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking Gillian Mackay for bringing forward this debate on behalf of her constituents, of course, who are here in the Chamber today. And can I congratulate those constituents on raising the profile of an often very complex issue of school transport on the national stage. I'm sure their campaigns really resonated with communities across Scotland. Because, you know, getting the wee ones out safely to school in the morning and back in the afternoon is a real challenge for many families. It really defines the working day for so many people. I remember those days fondly myself. And I'm also minded to think back to my former role as a councillor in Dunblane, where I supported many families who had similar school transport problems. In the case of Dunblane, a commercial bus service linking both sides of the town was withdrawn, and that left many pupils stranded. In the dark and wet, children like Ella would be struggling to get to school, while half-empty buses carrying distance-entitled pupils would go past, unable to stop. The distance-entitlement criteria meant that some of their friends in neighbouring streets could get the bus, while they couldn't. And in the end, more parents drove to the high school, causing more parking safety issues. Some of those who managed to walk did so on unlit paths. Those that cycled had the benefit of the National Cycle Network in the town, but of course there were unsafe crossing points for them to negotiate, and that put many, many children off. And that was at a time when there was no concessionary travel for children over 5 years old. Today, of course, there is free bus travel for all under-22s, and that has brought flexibility for young people and has supported commercial bus services. But there is a critical need here for councils to coordinate services between education buses and fare-paying services. And I think, as many members have reflected already, the critical element here is that parental engagement and planning. So at the start of last term, in Dunfermline, students were desperate to get on commercial buses going to Woodmill High School. And there was overcrowding with under-22 cardholders and fare-paying passengers to the point that some buses drove past students who were left stranded on the pavement. Some buses were late, others didn't arrive at all, which made it stressful for families while forcing teachers to then challenge lateness. One of my constituents told me, and I quote, "Having to provide comfort and support for my daughter as she transitioned to high school is naturally being part of a parent, but having to manage unreliable bus services and to tell her it's not her fault that the bus didn't stop or was a no-show was painful." Now, this term in Dunfermline, a new commercial bus service has been brought in to plug the gap and to meet that demand. But this could have been anticipated by Fife Council much earlier in the summer. So it's really important, this parental engagement and planning piece. But it's also important that councils consider how we make walking, wheeling and cycling to school more accessible, safer and fun for young people. Councils need to keep working on creating safer routes from the streets where young people live to their schools. The first step for that is safer 20-mile-an-hour speed limits. The next step is proper investment in walking, wheeling and cycle paths away from traffic with better crossing points and other improvements. Now, these will require funding in next year's Scottish budget so councils can deliver the Tier 1 projects at pace and finally complete their planned 20-mile-an-hour rollout. I hope that's something that the Transport Minister is listening to in this debate and can reflect on that in closing. Because the National Cycle Network in particular is a great resource that connects so many local streets to schools, but it requires investment to make it more accessible and safer. And of course, all these investments support health, road safety, traffic and pollution reduction. All schools must be supported to deliver bikeability training on the streets around schools while building a confident school cycle culture with bike buses and other programmes. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to thank Gillian Mackay and the campaigners again. You're very welcome in Parliament today. I wish them well, and I hope, hopefully, other school communities and councils across Scotland will take inspiration from your campaign, get the engagement right, and actually design the right school travel solutions for their community. It's a package of solutions that's needed. Buses are part of that. Active travel is part of it as well. But parents and pupils must be at the heart of that conversation.
Thank you, Mr Ruskell. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Oliver Mundell. Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank Gillian Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber this afternoon. In April 23rd, 2023, I ran a consultation on the safety concerns around this issue, I had an overwhelming response from those who took part to say that they could not see how this would improve pupil safety. I also undertook a walk from Cathedral Primary to Adele Street with pupils, parents and carers, including Kerry-Ann Ferry and some of the supporters in the gallery today. It crosses Airbles Road. This is a partially dual carriageway, which is due to undergo major extension work, joining the M74 to the M8, two of the busiest roads in Scotland to be joined in an arterial route through Motherwell that is declared a safe walking route for primary children. This Lanarkshire link will have a big impact on the area, and it's still in its development phase, and while that work is undergoing, we're likely to have additional traffic on the surrounding roads as well as this work is completed over the next 4 years. This creates a dangerous hazard for our young people. On that walk, we had to negotiate traffic stop to cross a pedestrian crossing on Windmill Hill Street. Presiding Officer, I'm well known in this place for my campaigning on safety issues and starting the cross-party group on accident prevention safety awareness. And that's because my teenage niece was killed on a pedestrian crossing in 2003. And the reason being that the vehicle that did was involved in that accident with Mary could not see her and wasn't in a position to see her because the traffic was stopped across a pedestrian crossing. Imagine that from a teenager, but imagine a primary one, primary two pupil in the same situation trying to negotiate gridlock traffic at rush hour in Motherwell. This is really of such great concern to me. I also want to mention that I am a member of the Catholic community in North Lanarkshire and a supporter of Catholic education in the area. And Education Scotland's HMI report in 2003 on these proposals highlights that they had met with church representatives from the Archdiocese of St Andrews in Edinburgh, Diocese of Motherwell and in Glasgow, and they reported that they have a concern that this will impact Catholic education because the catchment areas for Catholic schools tend to be larger, both for primary and secondary in schools, which makes it all the more unbelievable that there wasn't an equality impact assessment on this decision-making process in North Lanarkshire. They had no engagement with the diocese, no risk analysis that carries any confidence from parents and guardians, no meaningful engagement, as has already been said, and no consultation with the young people who are going to be affected, which flies in the face of everything we've been doing about young people's rights to be heard on issues that will directly impact them. I also don't believe there's been any additional investment in safe walking and safe cycling education or additional road safety education work either in these areas. And as has been pointed out from Mark Ruskell, the funds were there to do active travel, to improve safe cycling routes, to improve walking routes in the area. North Lanarkshire could have looked at engaging in those processes before making this decision, which has had such a devastating impact on our young people. And I also want to just finally say that that we know the budget issues are there, and we know that this is a problem for councils, but we also know that the unallocated reserves in the General Fund of North Lanarkshire run at 16% at £39 million, where COSLA itself and the Accounts Commission have said that a reasonable level is 3-4% of unallocated reserves for a council to be holding. So there is money there, as identified by the SNP group, and I hope and trust that this working group will look at it, the safety issues, and reverse this issue before there's any damage done. Thank you, President.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. And I now call Oliver Mundell. Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Gillian Mackay for bringing forward this debate. I'm clearly not an MSP who represents North Lanarkshire, but I do represent one of the other 27 councils referenced by Mark Griffin. And you know, I'm absolutely sort of behind parents who are campaigning on this issue, because the situation right now across Scotland, as the motion references, is unacceptable. And I do believe that the policy and guidance around these distance limits lies at the heart of it. It's not a coincidence that 27 councils, and I suspect more to follow, are coming to this decision. And it's guidance that's written for a different age. I think we're forgetting at the heart of this debate, we have children who are not making a choice to go to school. We make that choice for them. They have to go there. There's children who don't choose where they live. And also, I think there's always a danger as MSPs and politicians that we are behind this myth that all parents think it's important to get their kids to school. Yes, there are some in the gallery here today who are campaigning passionately on these issues, but there are also other parents where that's not their priority. Likewise, it's not their priority to think about what their kids are going to have for lunch at school. So I think on some of these issues, there is a strong case for universal provision and making sure that our guidance is fit for purpose. And I see in my own constituency children told that it's safe to walk down 60-mile-per-hour roads, single track, no pavements, often with ditches at the side, told that they can walk through fields in the rain, often fields that have got livestock in them for half the year, told they can get on public buses that don't exist, don't run to timetable, don't get them to school on time. And then, best of all, We have council officers, and I don't blame them because they've got a very hard job defending some of these changes, you know, who then say that because of health and safety at work regulations, they can't come and walk these routes with parents or young people because they're not safe. And I think it's, there's something not right is happening in the background. And I think we have to be willing to go back, because I think the policy itself should be based, as several members have said, on safety, not distance. And it should be equality impact assessed as well, because I think more than just there being a lot of cars on the road, which is clearly a problem, there are also lots of young people, I suspect, who are giving up on school, who are absent more often, people from families where they maybe don't have the support we'd all like people to see, who are disproportionately impacted by these changes. And secondly, which I know is touched on in the motion in terms of provision of buses more widely and investment in active travel, I also believe that if the guidelines were changed, there would be a greater encouragement there for local authorities and other interested parties to work on safe active travel. And I feel that, particularly as a rural member, we often see that these projects seem too difficult, too expensive, or not important enough. But I would draw the Minister and other members' attention to a project at Penpont in my own constituency that's seen millions of pounds spent putting in a safe cycle and walk route that's allowing young people at the boundaries of the 3 mile limit to be able to cycle and walk to school. So these things can be done if the will's there, but it needs government change to encourage local authorities to think again. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mundell. And I now call on Jim Fairley, Minister, to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And like Graeme Simpson, I will very much attempt to keep away from the politics, because there are a lot of local politics that are being described in the Chamber today. But I'd like to thank Gillian Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber, and for everyone who has contributed. It's actually been a really interesting debate. I've engaged considerably with Fulton MacGregor and with Claire Adamson over a long period of time. So this is clearly something that has got people talking, and it's something that people are looking for a solution to. I'd also like to pay credit to the campaign groups who are here in the Chamber today and who have been working very hard over a long period of time. Now, delivery of effective, fair, safe and climate-friendly home-to-school transport, it's clear it's an important responsibility for all local authorities, and I know that it's one that they do not take lightly. It's also of central importance to the Scottish Government priorities to tackle child poverty, to ensure high-quality, sustainable public services, and to tackle the climate emergency. So it's critically important that we work together to make sure that school pupils in Scotland can travel to and from school safely. Local authorities have wide discretion on how they meet their statutory obligations on home-to-school transport, and it is right that they do so. They are the ones who are best placed to make those decisions based on local knowledge of the transport network and the needs of all the pupils in their council area. That said, the Education Scotland Act 1980 sets out the statutory walking distances. These are long-standing features of our education system and broadly reflect the statutory position in other nations of the UK, and I can confirm that there will be no plans to change them at this moment in time. However, it is important to be clear that the statutory... Yes, I will.
Julie Mackay.
Would the Minister reflect that actually now, compared to the 1980s, these limits were put about before I was born? We're living in an entirely different time now in terms of traffic to when they were created. Roads are much busier, they're much more dangerous for children, and actually the fact that they haven't been reviewed in so long is an absolute failure of us to the safety of those children.
Minister.
I very much take on board the point that Gillian Mackay makes, but as I said, there are no plans to change those at this moment in time. I absolutely accept that infrastructure has been changed over that period of time. What I'll come on to talk about is the safety element of what local authorities should be considering. Because it's important to be clear that the statutory walking distances are only one element to be considered, and they do not negate the duties of local authorities in relation to pupils' safety. And that's a point that was made by Oliver Mundell as well. Where routes are considered unsafe, then alternatives should be considered, including the provision of transport, even if that distance does fall short of the statutory eligibility criteria.
Stephen Kerr.
He said should be considered. Would he not agree it is must be considered?
Minister.
Yeah. They have a statutory duty that they should consider these positions, and I would have expected any local authority to have taken that point on board. Where routes, the Scottish Government expects the local authorities to keep the school transport eligibility criteria under review, taking into account factors which might affect pupils' safety, and to meaningfully engage with the pupils and families when considering the impacts of changes. And I think that's a point that's been made a number of times today about that that consultation process. Excuse me. Yep.
I will. Megan Gallagher.
I thank the Minister for giving way, and I promise I won't be too long, but these are just words. And I think it's helpful today, if there was a review to be agreed, or for the government to say that they will move forward and consider a review, that's not only going to benefit parents, but the children and the safety that we're talking about today.
Minister.
I'm going to keep moving on, and perhaps without the interventions you may get some of the answers to some of the points that you're making. The Cabinet Secretary for Transport, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills and I have commissioned an update to the Scottish Government School Transport Guidance for local authorities to provide further clarity and to highlight the points that I've made this afternoon and the points that have been made by a number of different people in the Chamber. And the updated guidance will set out our expectations for factors local authorities should consider when making decisions on the provision of school transport. I understand the disappointment of pupils and families in areas such as North Lanarkshire, where the local authority have chosen to bring in changes to the distance where eligibility for dedicated school transport is provided. In June, together with Christine McKelvey and Monica Lennon, I met members of the North Lanarkshire Transport Action Group, and we heard directly from parents groups from North and South Lanarkshire about concerns over proposed changes, and in particular, the safety of the journey some children have been asked to make to school. And I welcome the fact that North Lanarkshire Council's decision to set up a working group to review the school transport provision for their primary schools in advance of the proposed reductions to eligibility for school transport for these pupils next year. And I strongly encourage the Council, and indeed all local authorities considering changes in provision, to ensure that the views of the young people and the families are included in that exercise. Members have also referenced the Young Persons Free Bus Travel Scheme. This is a transformational policy. It's opening up opportunities to young people right across Scotland in leisure, in learning, in work and social activities, and keeping family ties very close. And that would not otherwise be available. At the same time, it's encouraging bus use among young people to create travelling habits, helping us to meet our climate ambitions. However, I would stress that that scheme does not change the specific responsibility and the duties of councils in relation to the provision of school transport. It was not designed to replicate the dedicated home school transport, but the scheme gives young people access to an entitlement which allows them to travel independently for free across the whole country. To mitigate potential child safety risks, parents' or guardians' consent is required for under-16s, and that allows those who know the child best to make a careful judgment about whether they are suitably equipped to exercise their entitlement responsibly and safely. And that right should not be used as a proxy to remove the obligation to provide school transport for young people when required. And that was very eloquently described by Mark Ruskell, some of the issues that that causes. He also talked about the homeschool transport going beyond the school bus. So over the last 4 years, the Scottish Government has invested over £500 million in walking, wheeling and cycling, including £157 million for this year. For 2024-25, the delivery models for infrastructure and behaviour change projects have changed now and now provide direct funding to local authorities and regional transport partnerships so that they can drive forward local priority projects, including those that will support pupils and their families to walk, wheel or cycle for the school run. And in respect to safety, we have supported bikeability delivered through Cycling Scotland with over £2 million of funding for 24-25. A record number of Scottish councils delivered on-road cycle training at every local primary school last year. And there is continued investment in this area is critical to school children being safe on our roads. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I reiterate my thanks to all the members for their valuable contributions this afternoon. It is of key importance that all parties involved in the discussions in North Lanarkshire and indeed in other local authority areas in similar circumstances reach a settled position to minimise disruption and the concern for young people in their areas. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2:30 p.m. Thank you.